All right. Our talk for tonight is called Humility, Hierarchy, and the Aquarian Age. And we'll review. What we're trying to do is understand Aquarius and the Aquarian Age so that we can work in harmony with the times and we can fulfill more easily the purposes of the evolutionary creation of which we are part. And it's a very difficult thing to study one thing by itself, to know the whole thing by itself alone, and it's usually much easier in terms of education to compare something or contrast something with other things. And so what we're doing is we are taking each sign of the zodiac, and we are on the basis of that sign relative to Aquarius, we're trying to get an understanding of our transition into the Aquarian Age. When we do that with each sign, we take a very few simple principles that relate to that sign, and from them relate it to Aquarius. And we're using the astrological mandala in order to come to that end. And the astrological mandala is a very compound, complex symbol of the entire universe. But it's a symbol of the entire universe in astrological terms, which means that there are several layers of complexity to get at the reality. It's all helpful and it's a fun thing to do, but I don't know that it is the best way to go about it. In the astrological mandala, all of the elements of astrology are in standard position. Constellations are lined up with the signs, and the signs are lined up with the houses, and all of the planets are in their sign of rulership, and implicit in the whole structure is the aspects. So when everything is all lined up in the standard position, it's like the tumblers of a safe, and we hope that they're lined up so that we can open up and get at the truth of things. What we're trying to do is understand the basic divine intents and the underlying relationships of things in the cosmos. If we can understand them more clearly, we can live more clearly, and this is a much better way of going about it than looking at many, many horoscopes. We're looking at the raw materials or source material directly. In our last talk, we noted the relationship of the first cusp and the first house to the cusp and house that came after it and the cusp and house that came before it. And we noted that there were very dramatic changes from one sign to the next or from one cusp to the next. The most dramatic changes in all of astrology come about from adjacent signs. For example, if you take Cancer, just as an example, Cancer is an emotional and sentimental sign. And it's plopped right between Gemini, which is sort of airy and indifferent about things, and it's certainly not at all sentimental. And then on the other side, it's wedged in between Leo, which is not at all sentimental either, and it demands that things be done one way or another. So what we noted is that the irrepressible driving force that is Aries becomes bedrock resistance when it becomes Taurus. And in relation to Pisces, Pisces is more like a resistless mist that Taurus resists energy and Pisces gives in to energy, so that the relationship between the signs on either side of Aries each use a different philosophy. Now, we saw that whether it is the consolidation of responsibility that happens when you pass from the first house to the second house, or whether it is being under the weight of a whole cycle of energy as the 12th house is, either of those two houses represented a basic change of state. And that's what the semi-sextile represents, is a change of state. And the most basic changes of state are consolidation, or what you could call deconsolidation. Now, the image that we used when we talked about consolidation or deconsolidation is an image that relates to form and to stuff and to matter. But when we're studying history or when we're studying cosmological history, we're thinking in terms of time and not in terms of space. And so what we concluded last time is that corresponding to the semi-sextile is a change of state in time. Meaning to say that from the past there is always a buildup that pushes us into the future, and whether we like it or not, because if we try to repress it, it just pushes harder. And we noted that the future has a quality about it that pulls us forward. So the fundamental changes of state in time are brought about by push and pull, working at the same time on the present, or quotidianously or synchronously, I don't know how to say it. Relative to Aquarius, the push comes from Pisces, because with the precession, we're going backwards through the zodiac. We're looking at history. And the pull from the future comes from Capricorn. And in order to understand the pull of the future, we're going to look at some basic ideas of Capricorn. And the ideas that we're going to look at are the ideas of humility and hierarchy. And we're going to do that in a rather miscellaneous manner. This is not an especially coherent talk. It's going to be all over the place. Now, when we think about terms like humility and hierarchy, it seems almost impossible that they would be associated with the same sign, because humility is so willing to take a back seat, but when you think about hierarchy, you think of social stratification and elitism and all of those kinds of things. But that's one of the things of astrology, that the seed of something that seems opposite, a thing and its opposite, are both found in the same sign. It's very much like the yin and the yang, the Tao symbol. Each of them, the yin or the yang, has the opposite, the seed of the opposite within it, so that there is no such thing as an unbalanced opposition, that you can only go so far in one direction without being pulled back the other direction, because the seed of the opposite is within that. All right, so now we want to understand hierarchy, and the first way we're going to begin to understand hierarchy or humility is through the study of simplicity and simplification. Concentration and simplicity have always been associated with Capricorn. It's like a crystal. In a crystal, things, the atoms are put together in the simplest way possible. And they, when they're in the simplest manner that they can be put together, they are the most concentrated that they are. And the consequence is that a crystal is highly organized. And everything becomes crystal clear because of that organization. So it is seen in the simplicity and the simplification of the 10th house as much as in Capricorn. For example, the 10th house rules professionals, and professionals know how to cut corners. and to do it with the least amount of effort. They know how to do that kind of simplification. And they get to be top dog by being able to have the smallest margins of error, which means they simplify things the most. Geez, we're already 3/4 done. So, whether one becomes a professional or whether pure carbon becomes a diamond, that takes time. And time has always been associated with Capricorn. It is one of those things that if you read history, especially if you read the great historians like Cornelius Tacitus, he points out clearly how people get exactly what they need at exactly the right time, and he takes relish in the fact that tyrants get their comeuppance as they should. So it's gratifying the way things happen in time, and they happen with a marvelous punctuality. They happen exactly when they are needed to happen. So for myself, I have found out that the Capricorn principles of concentration and simplification and hierarchy have been revealed to me in various ways, and most of them were humiliating. I remember the last time I gave these talks, I was sharing a kitchen with a couple of elegant French women. And when we would prepare our meals, we would be starting with really simple things, but mine remained simple all the way to the end, including the eating, whereas their simple meals, starting with the same simple elements, ended up being very sumptuous. And that was one example of simplicity. But we did a lot of talking while we were cooking together, and it brought to mind the first time I began to understand simplicity in terms of time in history. At one time, I worked at a spiritual center where the basic business of the center was conducted. And I was a very young person when I was there. And when I gave these talks the last time, it was at that same location. It was the headquarters of the Rosicrucian Fellowship. But when I was a young man and I was there working, I was just filled with the spirit of mysticism, and I was filled with enthusiasm, and I was irrepressible. All you had to do was push a button, and I couldn't stop talking about it. And at that young age, I realized that I could do anything. And I believed that with regard to spirituality, I could do everything. And so I had a certain amount of illusion or a certain amount of delusion. And time has rubbed off some of the hard corners, and I still understand that I can do anything. But I also realize that I can't do everything. Time just does not allow us to do everything because we have to be sequential. And time also produces its own kind of pressure with regard to the spiritual path with to becoming and unfolding our divinity. Paul tells us it's like running a race, that as time goes on, we become increasingly aware of how precious time is and how much time it takes to develop things. Just in developing a simple prayer life, it has taken years and years and years to make just a very little advance in all of that. So when we're young, we have this feeling of a physical immortality. Death just isn't something that we think about. And we consider that there is time for everything. But the farther we go in life, the more we are brought to humility, because we look at the fruits of the things we've accomplished and they haven't been that much and they haven't been that great. And we realize that we are subject to the same mortality as everyone else is and the same limitations of the material world, and that is a humbling experience. So what happens if we are true to the spiritual path? As time goes on, we simplify. We discard the things that are more extraneous and the things that are more insignificant. We realize that some things are more important in life. So we have an understanding of priority. We know that there's a lot that we don't know. As we get older, that's another part of the humility. But we concentrate and specialize on the things that we know that are important for us to accomplish and not trying to accomplish everything. So that's a very simple example of the relationship between humility and hierarchy. Some things are more important than others, and we learn to simplify and concentrate on them. And if we don't do that in humility, or if we don't do that humbly, we are humiliated. Life is like that. You know, I'm not going to be one of those old people who wear stretch pants or something like that. All right, however it is stated, what we have stated, that's pretty much personal to me. I've tried to generalize it to the principle, but we want something more than that because we're talking about the Aquarian Age and we're talking about the mandala, which means we're talking about the entire cosmos. So we want something bigger, and that means a story, a myth, a story about the gods. Now, in most societies in the Western world, especially in what is called the Indo-European peoples, most of the societies or civilizations had the same gods. They had the same characters to their gods. Indra was the same as Apollo and was the same as Balder. They're all solar figures. But different societies value different things. And in India, the sun, that is Indra, was the chief of the regular gods. When things got to Greece, Jupiter, Zeus, was the chief of the gods. Jupiter rules abstraction, and the Greeks were a very abstract people. And by the time things got to Northern Europe, to Germany and Norway or places like that, it was Wotan or Odin that was the chief of the gods. They had a mercurial kind of view. Things were brought down from the spirit of the sun to the abstraction of Jupiter to the concrete thinking of Mercury as the people moved in that direction. Now, the myths are controlled by the racial or the cultural spirits, because a race or a culture is a vehicle that is used to bring people specific evolutionary experiences, because as human beings, we can't do everything. We need to learn specific things. And so the guiding spirits take care of how people dress, customary dress, and the languages, and the food that they eat, and the music, and even the things like clothing. The further we have moved from India to the West into Indo-European peoples, the tighter our clothing has been. And the tighter the clothing has been, the more we have become materially objective to the point that we become materially obsessed with stuff. And they controlled the mythology and the religion. Now, different people had not only different cultural spirits, which were ruled by different archangelic planetary flavored spirits, but they had different circumstances to live in. For example, in Persia, it was a rather rigorous climate. In fact, in northern Persia, it stretched right into what is now Afghanistan. And so their myths took a different flavor. They had a lot of myths about wolves and things like that. But the Egyptians, that was a very wealthy society, and they had a mild climate, and they had all of that fertility, and so they lounged a lot. It was not what you would call a hard-working society. And as a consequence, their gods were pictured as lounging a lot. They would go to the beach. And one day, a major pout of gods was lounging along the banks of the Nile. In Egypt, if there was a collection of gods, three or more, it was called the pout. And every city had its own pout. The city of Chemenis, which is where our word chemistry or alchemy comes from, had the great pout, and that had the 12 gods that were common to the Egyptians, which is one of the only places we have the story left intact. But at any rate, the major pout of gods was lounging across along the Nile River, and suddenly Typhon is upon them. And Typhon is sort of a giant bad guy. He's a titan that is constantly harassing the gods. And they didn't have time to armor themselves so that they could defend themselves. And they probably wouldn't have done that anyway, because if you get used to lounging, you become decadent and you don't like fighting. You consider that to be not a very cultural thing. So what they each did then was they each transformed themselves into an animal and dealt with things. The Zeus figure changed himself into a ram and went running off. And the Apollo figure changed himself into a crow and flew away. And the Hera figure, the divine mother, changed herself into a cow and also ran off. And Ares, that is the Mars, changed himself into a bear and went lumbering off. And Aphrodite, that is the Venus character, true to character, changed herself into a timid little fish and jumped in the river where she was safe. The lunar figure, the Artemis figure, changed herself into a cat and she climbed into a tree. And the Mercury figure, being cunning, changed himself into an ibis. And he stood in the water and he felt he was protected there because he didn't think Typhon would go in the water. Cronos, who is the Capricorn Saturnine figure, turned himself into a sea goat. And he was clever, like the Hermes figure. He knew he would be safe in the water and he could dive underneath if he needed to, but he could have an eye as to what was going on land. And that's pretty much the Capricorn idea. The Capricorn in the zodiac really is a sea goat. And it is the house of perspective, the principle of perspective. He wanted the perspective of safety of the water and the perspective of power in land or in society. Now, if you are on land, probably the best perspective that you have is from a mountaintop, because from the mountaintop is the only place that you can see a wide vista, that you can see a panorama. I myself like to go and climb towers. I like climbing fire towers and things like that. And what I try to do, I get up to the top of a tower and I try to pirouette like a dancer and try to hold in my consciousness the whole 360 degrees, not having that eyes in the back of my head, pineal quality, so that I can see the whole panorama, and I'm stuck with my eyes, at least I can get the effect of 360 degree vision. Vincent van Gogh had a very strong 10th house, and he recognized with that the importance of perspective. And he would actually carry a board around with him that by looking at the borders of the board that he could tell how perspective would be held if he was drawing something or if he was painting something. Cronos, who is Father Time or who is Saturn, was the god of time. And in Rome, it was the god Janus, the two-faced god. And some people do think that that is a good description of Capricorn. But there still is that very beautiful temple to Janus in Rome that you can go in and see it, and it's a marvelous experience. One face faces one direction, one faces the other way. In time, it's the time of New Year. And so that's when you're looking back on the old and looking forward to the new. Now, there are many ways of looking at perspectives in time, which is what we're trying to get at with history and evolution. And there are statements of time that link the linearity or the cyclicity of time together with hierarchy. There is a statement that is made in two places in the Bible that talks about that. In one place, I believe it's in the Apocalypse, where it says, "The first shall be last," which is a statement of precedence and priority. Precedence being the first, being the first, and the last is the statement of priority. The other way that it's stated is in St. John's Gospel. It said that he that cometh after me is preferred before me because he was before me. That's a very important statement. We're going to try and get to that. It's a statement also of priority and preference. Who is preferred above other people? So when we're talking about hierarchy, we're talking about priority, precedence, preference, and perspective. All of them are parts of hierarchy, and all of them are ruled by Capricorn. And a lot of this is a result of having spent 3 years lecturing on hierarchy in mythology, and I did get some pretty good understandings from that. Now, the large-scale cosmological history, which is even bigger than the precession of the equinox that we're studying, there is, according to that, people who have the consciousness that can see things of that magnitude, we are now at the nadir of spirituality. That is, we are furthest away from pure spirit, and we are at the maximum of materiality. It may be that we may not be a dead center, but you know, we're within a few thousand or a few million years, which in terms of cosmology is not very much. It's a short amount of time. And this is a very important time in cosmic history. And when we are in this material state, we have a very unique perspective. And with that unique perspective, we can begin to understand the reflective symmetry of cosmological design of things. Now, in order to do this, we're going to go through something that should take years, but we're going to do it in about 3 minutes. We're going to look a little bit at the background of cosmogony and cosmology in terms of the mystery schools. There is, we've talked about it often, a pole, but when you think of a pole, you don't think about it like a rod or anything like that. You just think about it as two opposing dimensions. And in one of those dimensions, the potential is time, and that potential is filled with spirit. At the other extreme, the potential is space, and that is filled with matter. And in the very center is mind, which stands between spirit and matter. Now, the evolutionary creation in which we are in, which is, my goodness, this is taking more than 3 minutes. in which we are in is a activity that takes place in time and space. You might say the one is manifests itself in time, space as matter. And it does this in time. And the periods of time are very long and large, and they're all given astrological names, not because they have anything to do with these planets, except that they share the same character. Like the very first period has the character of Saturn. It's like the ground floor. And it takes place in worlds. But within those worlds are globes of matter in space. Sometimes the worlds are coincident with the globes, and sometimes the globes are within the worlds. And the whole thing is turning inward and out, spiraling in a very complex spiral that has about as many dimensions as string theory, but I'm certainly not trying to justify this in turn by talking about string theory. And within this interplay of globes of matter in space, interplaying with periods of spiritual consciousness in time, within this interaction, there are revolutions of consciousness, where the consciousness spirals through spirit and matter in such a way that it is waked up. So, this is a very crude drawing of something that can't be drawn, but it is, this is of the space end of things. There is, outside of this, it's unlimited, but these are different degrees of spirit being more and more materialized until you get to where we are now, where matter is a very crystallized, materialized, and condensed thing. It's very concentrated. Now, in some of these periods of time, I can't put a diagram of them up because it would be way too much and I don't want to go into it that far. The worlds are manifest before the globes, and that's what the description is that we have here. So what we're talking about are periodic revolutions of consciousness. But the image that we're going to have on the board is very inadequate. What is a better image is to follow resolution in music. Like you follow something and then a chord resolves into something else and your consciousness is taken into another dimension and then that resolves into something else and eventually it goes back to where it began. And it's also like a very good prayer or a very good inner work that you do on your own. You turn inward, 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 and you come to some revolution of consciousness, and then you come out. And then you go back in, and you go deeper. And by that rhythm, you find that if you just try to go linearly, you can't do it. But by progressively spiraling, you go deeper and deeper, and you get a more comprehensive understanding. So what's happening is that these globes where all of the different evolving beings, whether they are divine creators or whether they are creatures that are receiving and being brought to where they can wake up and become divine beings, they're all working within these different globes. And so what we're talking about is a process of spiraling. So you might say, let's put some color on here. My goodness. Oh, that's a lovely lavender here. You might say that the spirit cycles into matter. And it cycles and it cycles, and eventually it cycles another layer deeper and another layer deeper. And the whole business is like a spiral that works its way into the degree of materiality. That's what we're trying to talk about, is we're trying to say that spirit cannot hold its concentration, or does not think it is wise to hold its concentration and have everything happen all at once. Many did, because this is quite a variable experience. We have all kinds of little vignettes of consciousness, some of which last 100 million years, which is a short time. And you go through all these different states, and each one awakens a different part of our consciousness or instills a different potential within us. And that process continues. It is, again, a Capricorn principle. It becomes more and more and more concentrated until it gets to this. You might say that with regard to the evolutionary creation in which we live and in which we are partaking, this stuff is the limit of the concentration of God relative to our evolution. Can't go any deeper than that. What happens is that as we concentrate, things become more material, and consciousness becomes more discrete and more focused in materiality rather than in the general overall spiritual consciousness of things, you know, that it understands things. Once the nadir of materiality has been reached, then someone wakes up, and when they wake up, it's almost like death. After death, everything unwinds. You know, like as long as we live, we become more crystalline and we become more stone-like, and we're always going forward until we can't go forward anymore. The will to live has run out, and then we let go and everything unwinds. And so what we're talking about here is the physical body decomposes, the higher bodies decomposes, we draw the essence of experience out of them, and it's all taken into the spirit, and then we cycle again, hopefully not too much more deep into matter than we are now. Now, if we take one loop on this spiral, that's what this is meant to be. These are different worlds that during one loop of the spiral we are passing through. And this is a higher state of spirituality, this is a higher degree of materiality. And the whole idea is that when we are involving or coming into matter, we become more externalized, and as we pass out, we are internalized. And we're going to talk more about this as we go on. This is rather sketchy as it is right now. But the whole idea is that we go back the way that we came. But we go back with a totally different perspective. So the first things that we learn are the last things that we come to full waking consciousness of within any loop of the spiral, which is where the statement, and the first shall be last. And this state of existence is after this state of existence in time, you know, this realm of existence in time. So he that was before, he that cometh after me is preferred before me, because he was before me. And so it's talking about different states of consciousness, and even though the pictures are not very good, we have a little bit of the idea. This is the whole symbol of it. This is supposed to have wings on. This is called the caduceus of Mercury. This is considered the flying spirit, and this is the spirit matter pole. Now, the two snakes are supposed to be different colors. This one is meant to be a black snake, but a black snake on a black board wouldn't work very well. And it is the snake of involution. We back into matter. And the other snake is the snake of evolution, where we come out of matter and return to spirit. And so I decided we should have some pictures, as long as we're going to have a camera, rather than looking at my ugly face. So we're talking about this whole spiral process. Obviously, the caduceus of Mercury is much more simple. And it's only in two dimensions, and it's easy to work with. So if we look at a mountain from below, which is like this perspective, we're challenged and we're inspired, but there's a lot of illusion. I can remember one time I was living on the edge of the Anza-Borrego Desert in this valley, the same valley through which the San Andreas Fault runs. And every day I looked at this mountain, and the mountain went up, and then behind it was the peak. And I thought, well, I bet you I can make it up to that peak. And I walked a half a day, and I got to that first crest, and it was enormous area before you even started the ascent to the next crest, and then another enormous area behind that before you got to the peak. And those are the kinds of illusions that you have when you're looking from the bottom up. Matter is very limiting. There are all those shadows, and you can't see things the way at all things are at all. This is a real problem because most people have a bottom-up point of view. And this is what makes a lot of science fiction terrible. Most science fiction is not about the future. Most science fiction is an exaggerated extrapolation of the present. If there's something that the science fiction writer has as a peeve, he just takes it and runs it out into the future and makes it be really extreme. It's really not of the future at all. There are some people that predict future technologies and things like that, but most of it is not. I don't read science fiction, but I've gone to quite a number of science fiction movies, and they're all that same thing. They're all the extrapolation of the present into the future. What we're trying to get at is the bottom-up point of view is a human point of view. There are two perspectives. You're looking from the bottom up, or you're looking from the top down. The top-down perspective, because you're at the top of the mountain and you can see where every little crevice runs, there are not those illusions. And you have the full panorama. It has a totally different quality than when you're looking up from the bottom. So the top down is a God's eye point of view. It's a divine perspective. And the bottom up is the human point of view. Now, if we are to become, things had to have begun with the top down before the bottom up. The bottom up exclusively is a notion of linear time and materialism. That means they're born in illusion. Something lesser can't make something greater than itself. It's a logical contradiction. You know, the potentiality of being something greater than itself had to be there before that potentiality could be unfolded. And in order for us to become divine creative geniuses, we had to have that potential before we could unfold it, which means that this was built into us, or is described as being built into us from other divine creative beings. Now, the top-down perspective at the top of the spirit matter pole is universal. It's all over at the same time. It's eternal, and it's inward. Even the outwardness that we would think would be outward is still inward to it. So that is such that because everything is inward, when you're looking for the uttermost spiritual point of view, you can see through everything because it is within you. When you're looking for matter, from the bottom-up point of view, matter is opaque, and the limitations of consciousness, the consciousness is all about limitations. It's a much different kind of consciousness. we can only see things outside of ourselves. And if we look at the inside of something, we're just looking at the outside of the inside of something and not really the inside as it is experienced inwardly itself. So we're talking about two different kinds of consciousness. If we take the material consciousness and apply it to higher spiritual things, we're still just seeing the outward surfaces or appearances of it. That's what's frustrating, and that's what we talked about last time when we were talking about symbolism. So there are two very different varieties of consciousness, and ultimately the future consciousness, which takes both of them and unites them so that we see the within and the without by having universalized the outward objectivity and having externalized everything that was hidden within its within ourselves. All right. So the further we have proceeded into matter, the thinner the spiritual consciousness has become, until the point right now that many people don't even realize that they have spiritual consciousness. Spirit gives itself into matter, and it is drawn into it in its giving. And that is the point that we stand at now in evolution. They're absolutely terrible notes to work with. After the nadir is reached, after we have involved as far as we go, and we actually have too many loops on here, and we take the leap of faith across the gaps of the tails of the two serpents, we unfold, we are aware of ourselves, and we unfold the divine consciousness. We'll come to that a little bit more. When you can't hold something together, things unwind, they collapse, and they become re-universalized. And there is a retrograde quality to that, or there is a looking back quality of that, which continues even though the evolution of consciousness proceeds forward. There is both a forward and a backward activity that is dissolving matter back into spirit. That's where we are right now. We're just past the nadir of materiality. And even though it isn't the same thing as spirit, it's still pretty wonderful. If we look at it, everything is unique. Everything is different. If I look at Bob from here and then walk over 2 feet and look at him again, I see him altogether differently. And each point of view, each perspective is a unique thing. And it is very helpful for broadening our understanding. And each time we become more inward, we become more awake to unifying those unique points of view that we now have. Now, in all of this, you know, this is a very simplified thing that I'm presenting here. Everything that we are in our whole psychological, spiritual consciousness and our physical nature has been built into us. While we are creatures, the divine beings, the spiritual hierarchies, the gods, whatever name you want to call them, the Elohim, they have built things into us. And as the physical side of the universe goes into decadence, those things are expelled out of us. As we become creators, we get rid of all of the influence that has been pushed into us or has been developed into us by the divine creative beings. At that time, we will expand. if you look at any spiritual path now, they all talk about the expansion of consciousness. It's like it's this, everybody knows that this is what it is, that we're too limited here, that we're too small in our viewpoint, that we're too, provincial in our outlook. As we expel things, as we expand, as we become more divine, we become more creative. And so we're told, freely have you received, now freely give. When you're involutionary, you are a receiver. When you are evolutionary, you are a giver. We're even told it's better to give than it is to receive. We even have throughout Christianity these same principles. St. Paul tells us, for example, that there was a religion of Christ before. He says it is of the order of the priest of Melchizedek, which is talking about an involutionary state of humanity where it is all tied together. So let's return to the top-down and bottom-up perspective that is already in us, and let's try to understand our waking up in that. Let's return to something we spoke of the last time we met. We talked about the fall of humanity. Let's talk about the fall with regard to reflective symmetry. And we're talking now about lifting ourselves up by our bootstraps out of our fallen states. And we're doing that by the pull of the future and the push of the past. Now, the Rosicrucian philosophy was in modern times written out by Max Heindel. And he points this out very clearly in the story of the prodigal son, who left home and eventually ended up in a life filled with the husks of matter, and that the prodigal son, deciding to give up this horrid life and return to the father, is received, his urge is received by plenty of pull from above. This is our quest. Our quest is to raise ourselves out of the stupidity that we are in matter. And to do that, the pure spiritual way has been given to us by various spiritual teachers. Probably most preeminent of them is Christ. And he shows us an attitude by keeping our eye and merely receiving from Christ, shows us how we can rise out of matter with ease. My yoke is easy and my burden is light. But there's always that tendency to be pulled back to the opposite direction. We've been talking about the pull of the future and the push of the past. There's also a pull from the past and a push from the future. And they are perverse states. There are specific attitudes to have about the future and the past. And if we have the wrong attitudes about them, we get things utterly, we produce utter chaos in our consciousness. The attitude toward the past is objectivity. If we live subjectively in the past, and we have all these sentimental views about the good old days and things like that, we have not learned from the objective facts of the past. That is, we have become subjective about that which we should be objective. The same applies to the future. If we are too objective about the future, we become exactly what we want to be, but we miss the greater future. if we, the attitude toward the future is to be subjective, is to receive the future into us, and that is what pulls us forward. But if we say, I'm going to be this and this and this, we will be this and this and this, but we will be nothing more. And similarly, there is a pull from the past. I'm noticing it with age. There's a tendency to want to look back at the things that I've done and to be attached to them. And there really are sentimental things that are inhibitive of progress. Similarly, if we are not living aware in the moment, aware of right now, and if we are leaning too far toward the past, the future comes rushing on us. It doesn't pull us forward with an intrigue that we want to go into it and explore it. The future comes at us so fast that we can't handle it. And what happens then is we try to go back to a past that never was, and we have things like fundamentalism and reactionary things, you know, that old-time religion, and remember the good old days and that. A lot of people believe the golden age was in the past. Truly, we have to look for us at the golden age being in the future. Now, the beautiful thing about looking at our journey through spirit matter in this way is that the reflective symmetry, if we take that with the continuity of consciousness in cause and consequence, nothing is lost. We don't have to worry about losing cultural artifacts from the past, because everything that was in the past, the essence of them, is going to be rediscovered in the future with a totally different perspective. And so the ideas of recreating ancient societies and holding on to things, old things from past times, are well intended, but they're very much misguided. You know, if you have the essence of things and if you have the conditions under which things were produced, you don't have to have all of the things. They come to life as you need them and as you create them or recreate them, because the future is going to be creative. It's not going to be something that happens to us like history or things from the past. All right. Now we have a little bit of the idea of a hierarchical perspective with a cosmic scope. Now let's go back and try to look at it again from the personal point of view. Let's try to narrow in a little bit on our lives. And narrowing in is the right set of words. From the top down, from that within going out consciousness, you have the consciousness of the grandstand. You can see better than the players can because you're on the outside and you're looking in, and there is no subjectivity. It's all a matter of creation. And in the creation that we're talking about, or that we tried to describe in these rude diagrams, it is a process of concentration. The spirit, the one, the universal spirit, is projecting its dream of what could be, its cosmic scheme of what could be. And that process is a concentrative process, much more than it is an additive process. And by that, in ancient times, the seers and spiritual philosophers said that matter was carved out of space, and that space was truly a plenum. And I don't know if they'd mean by that the same thing as modern physicists when they're talking about dark matter and dark energy, and all the things we can see are only a very small portion of the universe. What we're trying to say, yes, there is an imaginative projection of a dream, an externalization of a dream to objectify it and to know it, but it isn't all completely like the projection of a movie. It's much more like sculpting where you have your block of marble and you realize that the statue that is your dream is within that, and you keep chipping things away, and you do that in a very negative way. You do that in a Capricornian way. You say, is this part of my dream? No. And another shard is off of the block. And you keep on going that way until you have objectified what you inwardly believed was true all along. So there is a realization of a dream in that fashion. And because it is a creative activity, and because there is an unknown, and because there is something new for the divine spirit, the divine creator, just like there is for every other creator, it is a, I don't know how to say it, it is a negative process. If you're trying to understand something, like proving a mathematical theorem, you do what Plato did in the Meno. You ask your intuition at every step of the way until you come to the universal understanding. In this case, it's negative. No, it's not this, it's not this, it's not this. This is what it is. And that is how things are brought into what we call blind matter, dumb matter. And it's not surprising that following the same process, because we have objectified something and we haven't completely understood it yet, that's only part of the creation, it's not surprising that most of our creations are unsatisfying. They're never what we wanted them to be in the first place. If we weren't unsure in the first place, we never would have been drawn into creating and saying, what is this in myself that feels unfulfilled? That feminine that draws us on into the future in a very high creative cosmic state. We wouldn't even have the awareness of the ignorance that is part of that pull. At any rate, it is a relief to externalize our insecurity, even for the divine. We're told that in the beginning was the Word. And a lot of people believe that that original word was a laugh, because there is a relief at the insecurity of something that could be, that has been my dream all the time inside of me, even though it's probably never going to be exactly what I want it to be, which means it has to be that way if there's going to be something new. In the externalization of that, there is a relief, and in that relief, there is a spirit of joy, and there is a spirit of laughter. Anyway, when the dream is made manifest with many, many hierarchical helpers, all of the deepest and the most fixed manifestation of it is unknown. It has to be brought to life. It's like the statue of Pygmalion and Galatea. Galatea was a statue that had to be brought to life. This is an extremely meaningful myth and story, that the statue is an objectification of exactly what we are insecure about in our ignorance, but to really know it, it has to live. And it has to become us in spirit, because that's what we truly are. And that is what goes on in the process of creation. All right. The terrible notes. I'm sorry if this is coming out in a very haphazard way, because the notes are haphazard and I didn't have time to go through them all over again. All right, let's bring this closer to home and let's look at ourselves with the God's eye perspective. Suppose we are hewing a delicate statue out of marble, and suppose we're nearly finished, and we're at a crucial point and we make a misdecision and we shatter the peace. So that part of the statue is broken away and it can't be put back, at least it can't be put back into its original state. Normally things like this happen when we aren't concentrating, when we aren't paying attention. We get distracted, and usually the biggest distraction is the wrong kind of self-consciousness. We're thinking about ourselves in a very egoistic way. How do we feel when we do something like that? Obviously, we feel pained and we feel regretful. We always say, if only I hadn't done this, or if only I had done that. And let's take another example. Suppose you're playing an accompanied solo with an orchestra, a very beautiful symphonic piece, and then you decide to show off or to showboat and do something that isn't in the original score. And as a result, you pull the whole orchestra off and everything goes to pieces. And even you, without the orchestra to back you up, you go off on a tangent somewhere. Again, we ask ourselves, how do we feel? In this case, we feel probably worse because we have let other people down. We have failed them. We have not been part of the team or the orchestra. Suppose further that we're doing something of great importance, and we're doing it for those who depend on us, and it's supposed to be done with innocence, in purity, in sensitivity. We're supposed to be like a child. How do we feel if we become self-centered and abuse the trust that has been placed in us? We feel remorseful. We feel pained. These people didn't deserve, for all of the trust and everything they gave to us, they don't deserve to be treated like that. Now, if we take the feeling of these errors or the scenario of these errors and we think about them in terms of our evolutionary creation, it gives us a feel of something what the fall of humanity must be like for the divine spiritual hierarchies. It hurts others because they love us. I did things in my youth and in my young manhood that hurt my mother, especially my parents both, but it hurt them dearly, even though they didn't do anything wrong. Because they love, they feel hurt. It hurts ourselves. When we realize what we've done, we say, oh my God, what have I done? We're talking about remorse, but we're talking about remorse of a cosmic scope. And because we indulge ourselves in everything, we indulge ourselves in remorse. And remorse indulged in is guilt. And as a consequence, consciously or unconsciously, for what we have done in letting down the creation and the creators who have helped us, we carry around a very big burden of cosmic guilt. Now, I don't mean to imply by these pictures or stories that we as human beings are capable of disrupting the entire harmony of the entire creation. That would take more than our unfolded creative capacity is capable of. All I'm trying to say is that we have brought a very painful element of disharmony into the cosmos, and we have made it much more difficult to attain the ends of the evolutionary creation, and we've made it more difficult for everyone to be able to do so, which is sort of like another image all of us have had, a puzzle with one piece missing. Here you have this glorious picture, but that one piece is missing, and you notice that right away. The capacity for love of divine beings is much greater than we suspect, and eventually that love is going to correct our errors. But for right now, we are perpetrators of unnecessary pain in the cosmos. The intensity and the extent of our discordancy, of our remorse and guilt, are significant for the being that came and brought the kind of consciousness that allows us the ability to be redeemed. And all we actually have to do is receive it. But that brings in another level of pain brought on by our level of perversity. In my life, I have learned 3 lessons about love. I'm not sure I've learned them completely yet, and I'm not sure that I know a lot about the subject, but these are some of the dearest things I have learned in life. I've had to pay a very hard price, or a very high price, in order to come to these 3 principles of love, but it was worth everything that I suffered. They all have to do with freedom. The first principle of love is that, how to say it, we cannot be loved unless the being that loves us does so in freedom. We can't make anybody love us. We can't at all do that. In our insecurity, if we try to force someone to love us, we have the opposite effect. This is beautiful. This means that when we are loved because the person who loved us in complete freedom. They didn't have to. There's another kind of compulsion, but it's certainly not the kind of compulsion that we think of that has about it coercion or anything like that. The third law of love is the law that it isn't any of our business if we are loved. Doesn't make any difference. It's not ours to worry about. Ours to worry about is if we love. That's what our responsibility is, because if we can't control other people, then it isn't our business to know that we are being loved. It's a wonderful thing to be loved, and we blossom in it, and we are very fruitful in it, but it isn't any of our business whether we're loved or not. And all the time that we spent, whether we're saying, oh, nobody loves me, or this special person doesn't love me, as long as we think that way, we're wasting our time, we're wasting all of our psychic energy. The second principle of love that applies to this situation is that love must be received in freedom just as it is given in freedom. It isn't any of our business whether someone accepts our love or not. Our love may be beautiful, it may be pure, it may be true, and it may be just the thing to help the person, but if they don't accept it, it's painful to us if they don't accept it, because we know how good it is, but they have to have the freedom to receive or not receive. So for us, in a cosmic context, we are the source of a redoubled pain because we don't accept the cosmic love that is given to us, because we don't know how to be loved. We don't know how to let go of our closed selfishness and open ourselves to love so that we can be redeemed. and so that all of the pain and anguish of the fall gets redoubled by our perverse unwillingness to receive the thing that could redeem us from the fall. So here we are, blinded in matter, entrenched in materialism, but there are some blessings to that, because we have to remember that we're like little children. Even though we are divine beings and at the core of our very being we are gods, we're still little children. Our awareness and sensitivity to our misdeeds has also been turned off or muted by our materialism. Because we probably, if we had full awareness of the things that we have done, the heinous monstrosities that we have put out, we probably couldn't bear up under that. So we've become blind and insensitive. We still have the responsibility, which is called a cumulative burden of sin, but there is a blessing in not being completely sensitive to it, because it would have been too much. Corollary to that is another blessing for our situation. We're in quarantine in this materialistic blindness where we can only see with the senses and we don't have the spiritual vision. We are allowed to work here at our own pace. Our work is by the sweat of our brow rather than by the ease of that love that is given to us if we want to take it. But if we had been weighed down with guilt and remorse, it would, we wouldn't have accomplished. We have been forced by necessity to be inventive. Going by that old adage, necessity is the mother of invention. And so we have developed abilities. And we've taken all of the luciferic energies and we've turned them into science and technology, and we've done some wonderful things. Some of these things we have used to extend and to deepen our perversities, but that's always a temptation that is there. And some of the things, we have not been kind to our younger brothers and sisters, the kingdoms that are beneath us, we have poisoned them, we have slaughtered them, and we've done all sorts of things like that. But nonetheless, we've accomplished some things, and we've worked very hard on them. And as a result of these accomplishments, looking at it from the small point of view, from the bottom-up point of view, we think we're pretty good. Now, if a child, say like a 6 or 7 year old, had to play baseball with Willie Mays every day, there would be a horrible inferiority feelings that would come up. What I'm trying to say is if we saw the magnificence of the creative work of the divine beings and looked at that all the time, we would be cowered in our insecurity because our creative efforts have been feeble. But being locked in materialistic blindness, we have developed some self-esteem. We've developed soul power. We feel good about ourselves. And we've gotten so far that we even feel cocky. From the materialistic point of view, we're the top of evolution. And that we haven't been very good to the things that are below us in evolution. We're arrogant in our top-down viewpoint that is really from near the bottom. And this is dangerous. Because if we become more and more egoistic and more materialistic, we become progressively more and more isolated. We have bad attitudes. We don't want to cooperate. This morning's paper had another diatribe against mass transit. No, we don't want to share with somebody. We want to be shielded in our own little car. You know, I think the epitome of United States society would be to have a drive-in BN. You would be with other people like in a drive-in theater, but you'd be shielded and protected in your own little car. We hide behind the television, and we don't communicate with other people, not even by telephone or cell phone, or now they have these new tweeters and all of these things. And what they are all symptoms of are symptoms of loneliness. When you think you are your body, that's a very isolated state. Rather than sharing the same spirit and learning to communicate the same spirit with someone else, you are very isolated in your one little body. You're alone. But the loneliness isn't all bad. Because when we're alone, we are forced to turn inward. And eventually, when we are sincere in our inward turnings, we make inner breakthroughs. And when we make inner breakthroughs, we are surprised, even with little steps forward inwardly. As we make greater and greater inner, I don't know how you would say it, steps forward in inward consciousness, nothing is hidden from us. Like we said in the beginning of the last talk, we can see everything to the Godhead. Now that, the responsibility for everything we have done, and the awesome consciousness of all of the divine beings are above us, will be humiliating. We thought we were the top when we are somewhere down near the bottom. That's humiliating to think that we have been that way. Hopefully, it'll also be humbling. We'll see all of the divine glories, things that we have evaded for a long time. Hopefully, we will not be made humble through humiliation, because true humbleness comes from something other than humiliation. For example, walking out on a starry night and being awed by the extreme majesty of just the visible universe can do more to humble a person than taking a good drubbing from somebody. Just think of how much more a view of the divine beings and of all of the pure spiritual truth. Humility doesn't keep us down. Humility is really the basis of our resurrection. It is the basis of our ascension, our apotheosis. It's only when we are humble that we can judge ourselves with that accurate Capricornian Saturnine judgment. It's only then that we can climb with sure steps, because we see exactly where we are and what we are capable of. So this gives inspiration to a bottom-up perspective by being able to see something above us to emulate, to look up to. So, we have then spiritually living role models. We have something to work forward to, something that pulls us toward us. Now that pull is elucidated very clearly in the Divine Comedy by Dante. When Dante goes into hell, and the lower regions, it is a human being, or the ghost of a human being, the ghost of Virgil, that takes him down into the underworld. When he passes into the spiritual worlds, it is by Beatrice bringing him there. Each time he feels a need to look to Beatrice, he looks at her, and the beauty of her elevates him so that he rises to a different level. Now, that's not just poetic fiction. That is spiritual reality. Every time that we look deeply and drink in something deeper and higher than us, it uplifts us. We don't have to do a whole lot of effort. All we have to do, this is again that effort to relaxedly receive. Christian mystical aspirants know that they have a promise, that they'll know the truth, and that the truth is part of a divine being, the human-like focus of that being Christ, who said, "I am the truth." Christ, or at least the biblical Christ, said, "If I be lifted up, I will draw, or I will lift the world up with me." And that is the pull of the future. It is a pull of love. The way Paul says it, we love him because he loved us first. And that kind of love being given to us, when we receive it, when we eagerly reach for it, is the pull of the future. You have a question?
Yes.
Yes.
It may be a little out of context, but you, about 10 minutes ago, you were talking about how you had learned three things, and you were talking about love. And I may have misunderstood, but did you say at some point that...
I said number one first, number three to second, and number two...
And somewhere in between, you said, it isn't any of our business if we are loved.
That's right.
I don't understand that.
Our business is to love.
Oh, I see.
It's not our business to know that we're loved. It's nice to know that we're loved, but all of the people that spend all of their time trying to make themselves lovable or be loved, you know, that's what sells cosmetics and all of the other stuff.
Okay, I didn't understand
yeah.
that.
It isn't, right. Yeah, it isn't.
I thought, well, if we're supposed to receive this love, then if it's not our business, if we're loved, like,
oh, we know we're loved, but you know.
No, I get it.
Yeah. It's just, we know we're worth being loved.